Good evening. First, two very exciting bits of news. An Anglo-Japanese satellite had been launched from the Kagoshima rocket range in Japan. It used to be called Astro C, but the Japanese now call it Ginja, which I gather is the Japanese word for galaxy. My Japanese is a bit rusty. And there's an impression of the satellite. The main instrument is an X-ray telescope. And this is tremendously important because we can learn a great deal about X-rays from space. We should be getting results from that in 3 or 4 weeks' time. And of course, we'll have a great deal more to say about it later. And then, on the top of Mauna Kea in Hawaii, at 14,000 feet, there is the James Clerk Maxwell Telescope. And this is operating now in the sub-millimeter range. You can see some of the optical telescopes in the background. And we've just heard that it's going to be officially opened on April the 27th by the Duke of Edinburgh. But we'll have more to say about it before then, because in April, the sky at night has its 30th anniversary. And we are doing a special program, which is going to involve a trip to Hawaii. This time last year, we were all very excited about Halley's Comet. Well, sadly, the comet has gone now, and I think amateurs are just as upset about that as professionals, because amateurs did a great deal of useful work in connection with the comet. And you know, in spite of today's ultra-modern, sophisticated equipment, the work of the amateur is just as important as it ever was. I think probably more so. Traditionally, the amateur has been concerned mainly with the moon and the planets. And there are always planets around. There are several in the evening sky now. You can't miss Mars, for example, in the general area of the square of Pegasus. It's so red. Jupiter is so brilliant, you can't mistake it. And for the first part of the month, you may also be able to see Mercury below Jupiter, although Mercury, of course, is never conspicuous, and not even large telescopes will show much on it. This is a sketch I made some time ago for my own observatory. It doesn't show very much. In the morning sky, we have Venus, which is so bright you can't possibly mistake it. And also we have Saturn with its lovely system of rings. But Saturn's going to be better placed later on in the year, and so I won't say any more about it now. In fact, I'm not going to say any more about planets, because I want to come on to another branch of astronomy in which the amateur can and does play a very valuable part, and that is the study of variable stars. Most stars, including the Sun, luckily for us, shine steadily for year after year, century after century. But there are some which don't. And amateurs can play a very useful part in studying these variable stars. And this is a very good time to start talking about them, because the most famous variable star in the sky, Mara Cetae, is now at its best after dark. Again, in the general area of Pegasus and Mars, it's actually in Cetus the whale, and you can see it shining almost as brightly as the pole star, and it's quite definitely red. And it's known as Mara, the wonderful star. It was the very first variable to be recognized. But for a long time every year, it's invisible with the naked eye. It's what we call a long period star, and it brightens and fades over a period of 332 days. And so when it fades down, it'll drop below naked eye visibility, and in fact, it may become so faint you won't see it even with binoculars. And then it brightens again, and it'll be at maxima after another 332 days or so. Now, that's the kind of star that amateurs watch. And what has to be done is to estimate the magnitude of the variable compared with other stars which don't vary. Magnitude is a measure of a star's apparent brightness. And it works rather in the same way as a golfer's handicap, with the more brilliant performers having the lower values. One is brighter than two, two is brighter than three, and so on. And I think I can best show you that by putting up a picture of Orion, which is high in the south now after dark, and I think everyone can recognize. In the lower right of Orion, we have Rigel, which is very bright indeed, just below magnitude naught. Aldebaran in the Bull, in line with Orion's belt, is fainter, magnitude one. Of course, the pole star, which of course is on the other side of the sky, in the Little Bear, that's magnitude two, and I put that on this figure because I think everyone knows how to find the pole star. Look below Orion's belt, and you will see a star, Iota, which is magnitude 3. And above the red Betelgeuse, you will see a fainter star still, Mu Orionis, magnitude 4. And by the time you've gone down to magnitude 6, you've come to the limit of naked eye visibility. Below that, you need optical aid. A 3-inch telescope, to that one, will take you down to below magnitude 10. My 15-inch telescope in my own observatory will take me down to magnitude 15 or so. And the world's largest telescopes, such as the famous Anglo-Australian telescope in New South Wales, and there it is, that can go down well below magnitude 20, 23, 24, something like that. But below the sixth magnitude, you do definitely need optical aid. Now, I must stress that a star's apparent magnitude is not a reliable clue to its real luminosity, because the stars are not all equally distant. And to show what I mean, let's go back for a moment to Orion. There is Rigel, magnitude naught, and in line with the belt in the Great Dog, we have the brightest star in the sky, Sirius, which is magnitude minus 1.5. That's a magnitude and a half brighter than Rigel. But Sirius is only 8.5 light years away and a mere 26 sun power, and Rigel is over 900 light years away and the equal of 60,000 suns put together. And Rigel appears fainter only because it's further away. So in this program, when I talk about magnitude, I mean the brightness a star looks, not how bright it really is. What your observer has to do is to estimate differences in magnitude. And with the naked eye, you can do that quite easily to a tenth. Let's go back to Orion. In the belt, there are three stars lined up. The middle one is Elnilam, magnitude 1.7. That is just a bit brighter than the pole star. Now look at the lower star, Alnitak, which is 1.8. The difference is only one-tenth of a magnitude, and yet I think you'll agree if you look that Alnilam is perceptibly brighter than Alnitak, and both are brighter than the upper star of the belt, Mentaica, which is actually slightly variable, but about 2.2. And so you have to estimate these differences. Now, we do that in various ways. I have put here a completely imaginary chart to show you the kind of way in which we work. There are three stars there, A, B, and C, which are non-variable and which I can look up in my catalogue, and I know that the magnitude of A is 3.6, B is 4.0, and C is 4.8. And so A is the brightest and C is the faintest. Now, in the same field, imagine we have a variable star and we want to estimate its brightness. What you do, at least what I do, is to train yourself to estimate differences of one-tenth of a magnitude. Suppose then I find my variable is three-tenths of a magnitude fainter than A, but one-tenth brighter than B, then quite clearly its magnitude is 3.9. And that's the way you do it. Mind you, things aren't as easy as that. You don't often get your nice comparison stars obligingly lined up. There are difficulties in comparing a red star with a white one, and just occasionally you have a real problem such as a variable comparison star, and I've found that before now. But that basically is the way in which it's done. And there are very many variable stars within amateur range. I've talked about Mara Ceti, a pulsating red giant star with a period of just over 330 days. It's one of many stars of the same kind, and there's one of these in Orion. It's well above Betelgeuse in the area of the fainter stars Chi-1 and Chi-2 Orionis. And there it is, indicated by the arrow, U Orionis. You're not going to see that without a telescope. It can only touch the fringe of naked eye visibility. But I thought you might like to see my own working chart of it, and here it is. Note that I've got white on blue, because you don't want to destroy your night vision by looking at a chart with a white light. Red is better, and red shows up white on blue rather better than it would black on white. Now, there's my chart. There's my comparison star, on this case, which I happen to know is magnitude 8.9, and there is the variable. Now, last time I looked, the variable was about 0.3 magnitudes brighter than my comparison. The comparison is 8.9, the variable must have been 8.6. And I think that's probably pretty accurate. I'll back myself to get to within a tenth or so. Now, that kind of star, you do need a telescope, but there are some variables you can estimate with the naked eye. And there's one good example in Gemini, the twins. You can find Gemini easily enough. It adjoins Orion. I think most people know the twins themselves, Castor and Pollux. And Gemini consists of long lines extending down in the general direction of Betelgeuse. And in the foot of the constellation, there is a variable star, Eta, and a non-variable star, or virtually non-variable, Mu. And Mu is magnitude 3.0, and at the moment, Eta is about half a magnitude fainter than that. Eta, I may say, ranges between magnitude 3 and 4 in a very rough period of about 140 days. But Betelgeuse and Orion, the red supergiant, that is itself variable between just below magnitude 0 and about magnitude 1. And there are two very good comparisons there. One is Aldebaran in the Bull, which is red like Betelgeuse, magnitude 0.85. And then Procyon, in The Little Dog, magnitude 0.4. Betelgeuse has a very rough period of about 5 years and varies very slowly, but you can track it. And at the moment, it's appreciably brighter than Aldebaran, but fainter than Procyon. I have seen it considerably brighter than Procyon. But there's one problem here, and that has to do with what we call extinction. A star's light comes to us by way of the Earth's atmosphere. And the higher the star, the less the thickness of atmosphere the light has to cross, and the less light is absorbed. Let's consider two stars, which are really equally bright, but one's higher than the other. The star that's high up has its light coming to us through a thin layer of atmosphere. The star which is lower down is shining through a thicker layer of atmosphere, more light is absorbed, and the star will appear fainter. So although really they're the same magnitude, the lower down star will appear the fainter of the two, and that's a measure of the extinction. It doesn't matter when you're considering a telescopic variable such as Uranus, because the telescopic field is small and the extinction is going to be the same all over it. It matters very much when you're considering a star such as Betelgeuse, which is some way away from its comparisons, and maybe, for example, lower down than Aldebaran but higher up than Procyon. That's something you've got to allow for. When you've observed a variable star over some period, you can draw up what's called a light curve, and that's a plot of magnitude against period. And I've been doing that for quite a number of stars, and I thought you might like to see one of my observing books, and here are my observations of a Mara-type star called R. Leonis in the Lion. And it's the same type as Mara, but considerably fainter. There are the observations, and here, in fact, is a light curve that I've drawn of it, and you can see it varies up and down fairly regularly. The period there is 312 days. Although for part of the year, it's too near the sun in the sky to be seen at all, and you have to interpolate. But that's the thing that can be done. But what different kinds of variable stars are there? So let's have a look at a few light curves. First of all, Mara stars. These are pulsating, unstable, old red giant stars with periods that may be anything from a few months up to more than 2 years. And neither their periods nor their amplitudes are absolutely regular. Then we have the so-called Cepheids. And here the periods are short, only a few days, and their behavior is absolutely regular, so we always know how these stars are going to behave. And they also are pulsating, changing in size and changing in output. But look then at this light curve, and that shows Algol in Perseus. And this time, as you can see, the star appears virtually constant, in Algol's case just below magnitude 2, for a period of 2.5 days, and then, quite suddenly, it drops. It gives a long, slow wink, taking 4.5 hours to fade down, remaining faint for 20 minutes below magnitude 3, and then taking another 4.5 hours to recover. And then nothing much more happens for another 2.5 days. So Algol clearly is quite different from Mara or Delta Cephei. And in fact, Algol is not genuinely variable at all. It's what's called an eclipsing binary, made up of two stars going round their common center of gravity. And when the fainter star gets in front of the brighter, every 2.5 days, there's a long, slow wink. So Algol is not a genuine variable. But you can follow it with the naked eye, and you might be interested to see what's going to happen to it in the near future. There's the position in the constellation Perseus, quite easy to find. And if you want some convenient minima, there's one on February the 25th at 0.9 hours. That's about 5 to 1 in the morning. 27th of February, 21.8. And March the 19th, 23.5 hours. And if you look at Algol at those times, you'll find it's a magnitude fainter than normal. And it's very interesting to watch it fade down, remain faint for 20 minutes, and then slowly recover. I think, you know, of all the variable stars, I'm most interested in those whose behavior you can't predict. And there's one very interesting specimen about which we've just had some fascinating news, and that is called R. Coronae. To find it, begin, first of all, as we often do, with Ursa Major, the Great Bear. Follow round the tail of the bear and come to the brilliant orange Arcturus. Not far from Arcturus is the little semicircle of stars, which we call Corona Borealis, the northern crown. And if you use binoculars, you will be able to see that inside the bowl, where the brightest star, by the way, is Alpheca, second magnitude, inside the bowl, there is a star, which we call M, which is magnitude 6.6, that is just below naked eye visibility, but easy with binoculars. You will probably also see another star, and this is the variable R Coronae, which is normally just about magnitude 6, on the fringe of naked eye visibility, and very easy indeed with binoculars. But although our corona is usually about the sixth magnitude, at times, and quite unpredictably, it drops down so markedly that it may go below magnitude 15, and then it's very difficult to see, even with a big telescope. This is a light curve that I drew of a fairly recent minimum. As you can see there, in January, the magnitude was 6. In April, it fell down to about 13, and it didn't recover until the following summer. And that wasn't a very deep minimum. It can go down much further than that. Now, our corona is a very mysterious star. It's very luminous. It's over 5,000 light years away. And although it's not an eclipsing binary, it's an intrinsic variable, we believe that it's not a pulsating star in the way that Mara is. We believe it hides itself behind clouds of soot. Unlike most stars, it's very poor in hydrogen, very rich in carbon. Normally, the light comes straight through to us, but periodically, particles of carbon, which you can call soot if you like, accumulate in the star's atmosphere, and they literally blanket the light, and so the star fades down. And it remains faint for some time until the radiation below actually blows the soot clouds away and the star climbs back to its normal brilliancy. A very strange star indeed, what we call the sooty star. Now, the interesting thing is that we have now got some observations made from the infrared astronomical satellite IRAS, which operated throughout most of 1983, but not all the results are in yet. And this work's been carried out by the American astronomers Neugebauer, Gillette and Blackman. And this is the discovery of a huge shell of material around our corona. And they've sent us a false color picture of it. These colors are not, of course, genuine. They represent differences in intensity, and our corona itself is in the middle there, in the white area. Now, this shell appears to be at least 25,000 years old, and it is huge. Diameter, something like 26 light years. And therefore, if our sun were the center of a comparable shell, then nearby stars, such as Sirius and Poseidon, would be inside it, and Altair only just outside. So what exactly is this strange shell around our corona? It appears to be made up of very thinly distributed silicate and carbon particles, and it's persisted because our corona is in a fairly calm part of the galaxy, well away from the main plane. But just exactly how it was formed is something that we don't know. And there are more mysteries still. It appears to be at a constant temperature, but from what we can gather, it's not actually being heated by our corona itself. So there's some external source of heat. What it is, we don't know. It may be a hidden radiation source. It could possibly be something to do with an external radiation field in the galaxy, or something intergalactic. But it is very much of a mystery, and we have no idea exactly why that shell is there. Another thing we don't know is whether other stars of the same kind have comparable shells. Because our corona is an unusual kind of star, but it's not unique. But whether these other our corona stars have got shells of the same kind is something we haven't yet found out. I rather suspect that they have, because I don't suppose our corona is unique, but we've simply got to wait and find out. But certainly you would agree that our corona is a most remarkable star, so next time you have the chance, have a look at the bowl of the crown with binoculars, and see whether R is visible or not. And if not, you'll know it's doing one of its totally unpredictable fades. So just why do we observe variable stars? We want to find out how stars work, how they evolve. And variable stars, which actually perform for us, so to speak, can give us very valuable clues. There are so many variable stars that professionals can't possibly keep them all under constant survey. And that's why the work of amateurs is so warmly welcomed. And if you do decide to take up variable star work, and you don't need a large telescope, then I can assure you, you'll find it quite fascinating. Certainly I do, if only because one never knows what many of these variables are going to do next. Good night.